Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming to celebrate the release of this wonderful book with us and to attend Roger's talk tonight. I know many of you, and I'm glad to see you all in one place. My name is Danielle Knapp. I'm the McCosh Associate Curator here at the JSMA. And just a little history, and I know this will be familiar to a lot of you. I'm going to talk just for a little bit before I hand it over to Roger. In 1990, Ann Kutka McCosh established the Memorial Museum Fund in her name and her husband David McCosh's name in order to preserve and promote an understanding of their work, especially David's. Everyone who knew Ann has told me that she was very persistent about wanting the focus to be on David's work, but we've certainly been able to use this opportunity to present her work as well. The fund supports the museum's initiatives in the research, care, exhibition, and dissemination of the McCosh Memorial Collection and its archive, and also promotes related materials and programs by other regional artists that provide a context for better understanding and appreciating the McCosh's work. And in the time, in the years since Ann established this fund, it has been used to make possible so many projects, exhibitions, programs, lectures, and book projects, and we are so happy to have that available to us to do this good work. JSMA Director Jill Hartz and I are relatively new to upholding this charge because in the nearly 20 years before we came on board here as JSMA staff, and certainly in the 8 years since, there have been such a dedicated committee who has been focused on seeing this endowment fund agreement followed through to the letter. And I'm so grateful to have so many of the McCosh Advisory Committee members here tonight. Roger Saydack, of course, and Hope Pressman, Craig Cheshire. We're so happy to have new members to the committee this year, Andrew Cook and John J. Crewson. We're so grateful for the contribution of past members, especially Mark Clark, who we lost last year, and our member emeritus, Bob Frazier, and so many past members who have been involved in this committee. It's just been an amazing community for us to be involved in. And of course, that community around the McCoshes is so much larger than that, too. We have over 20 collectors whose works were photographed for this publication. And if you are one of those collectors who I haven't talked to yet tonight, if your book has a photograph in it, please let our front desk know. They have a list of your names, and they'll make sure you get your copy. And how many people here tonight live with McCosh works? And how many people knew David or Ann in their lifetime? Okay. Is there anyone here who knows nothing about David and Ann McCosh, wouldn't recognize their work if it was in front of them? Great. So thank you. We need you. We need these people at our program. So this is my charge to all of us who love and know the McCosh's work. We need more of those people who raised their hand at that last question to come to our program. So tell them about the work. Tell them about this book. Bring them to the museum because we need more people. We want to fill this room twice over next time we talk about their work. So that's the challenge we all have. That's what I think the endowment fund is really about. So those are the new appreciators who will carry on this legacy. We hope that you will be continue to be a familiar face at programs that the collection and the endowment fund supports. Last year we kicked off our new memorial visiting lecture series on Northwest art with a great talk from Bonnie Lang Malcolmson. And so this spring soon we'll announce the timing and the speaker for our next program, so stay tuned to hear about who will be here in the spring. The Carr & Clark Gallery will have a selection of works by David McCosh related to this publication on view in March, and Roger will speak again there in March, so we hope to see you all there. And we have on view through February upstairs in this museum in our Graves Gallery a show of McCosh lithographs in context with some of his contemporaries. So the museum's open until 8 o'clock tonight. If you haven't seen that show yet, you have time after Roger's talk, and two of the works on view are works reproduced in the book, so you can see them in person. Okay, so I've talked a lot. You came here to hear this gentleman speak, and we're so happy to have Roger Saydack presenting this talk tonight. It's been a pleasure to work with him on realizing this book and recognizing 10 years of good work happening with this collaboration with the Carr & Clark Gallery and all the research you've done to celebrate 50 years of the McCosh's paintings. And so he said he's willing to sign books and answer questions after the talk, so we want to continue this conversation, but please welcome Roger. Thank you.
Well, thank you all very much for coming out tonight. It's great to see everyone here. I do have a promise for you. I'm not going to say a word about the election. And sometimes when you talk about paintings, you talk about transitions. None of that either. I thought I'd begin by thanking and acknowledging I'm dealing with one of the Eugene colds, so I'm periodically going to be using this. Thanking and acknowledging all the people who have supported this publication in so many different ways. The members of the McCosh Endowment Committee, as Danielle just mentioned, provided financial support. And I especially want to call out my great friend and mentor, Craig Cheshire, who is a fabulous advocate for McCosh's work and also the real McCosh expert among us today. The museum staff itself played an instrumental role. Jonathan Smith for his very fine photography, which you'll see in many of these slides and in the book. Diane Nelson for her impressive and effective design. Claire Sabat and Madeline Kern, curatorial interns who provided ongoing assistance throughout the project in a variety of different ways. We thank them very much for that. Danielle, of course, was the editor of the book and also the facilitator extraordinaire. She really kept the project moving, pulled it together in a variety of different ways, and we're very grateful to her for that. And Jill, of course, our museum director, who provided the full support of her staff for this project, and believe me, it never would have happened without that. And of course, all of you who loaned your work for photography for the book, we're very grateful, and you've made it a much better book as a result. I also want to especially acknowledge Karen Clark, who's sitting towards the back. This book came out of a series of exhibitions at Karen's gallery in Eugene, as Danielle mentioned. If you haven't been there, I really hope you do start attending it. It's a wonderful arts venue. And Karen is just a great champion for the art of painting and for David and McCosh in particular. So thanks very much, Karen, for your support. I thought what I would do today is to pull together some of the ideas that are in the essays in the book and talk about how David's belief, David McCosh's belief, in the notion that learning to paint is learning to see, drove his art throughout his career. And to do that, we'll be looking at a number of paintings and drawings from the McCosh Endowment Collection, which is the source of the artwork that was in the gallery shows and most of the work that's in the book. One of the remarkable aspects of McCosh's work is its consistent purpose over the years. He lived through times when painting in America was changing dramatically and rapidly. From the 1920s, when he completed his training, until the 1970s, when he retired, modernism, social realism, expressionism, surrealism, abstract expressionism, minimalism, and pop art all had their day. A tremendous range of styles and methods for creating art. Some painters during those years changed with the times and the trends. McCosh did not. The purpose of his painting remained constant during all of the turmoil that was going on in the art world, because for McCosh, painting was really about learning how to see what was distinct and special about his subject. And his voice as a painter and the look and feel of his art always reflected that simple yet profound concept. So in the next 45 minutes or so, we'll explore three approaches to painting as a way of learning to see that McCosh used. First, during his early years in particular, the goal of his painting was often to create a statement of the distinctive character of his subject. Then, beginning in the 1940s and continuing through the end of his career, his paintings were sometimes more about how he saw his subject than about what he saw. And then finally, towards the end of his career, painting for McCosh became a means of discovering the essence of his subject. So we'll start with character. McCosh always believed that the distinctive character of a subject was what remained after you eliminated all the generalities, all the non-essential details, everything that made one tree look like every other tree. McCosh focused on what made an individual tree unique and special and worth painting. In the mid-1920s, when McCosh was beginning to find his voice as a painter, he found that he made this simple watercolor. The subject's a rural landscape near his hometown in Iowa, but the painting is about that sweet feeling of home. That's the character of this place for him. In the late 1920s and early 1930s, when he was a student and then a teacher at the Art Institute of Chicago, his subject was frequently the people of that big bustling city. Here he is, in a very dashing self-portrait, looking right back at us. This is a man to be reckoned with, this painting seems to be saying. He often made drawings, prints, or watercolors during this period that created a short story or a vignette. This one involves a man and a woman and the situation they find themselves in at the dinner table. The drawing describes the character of these people and their situation and gives us a pretty good idea of what that conversation is all about. Here's a story about the loneliness of a public place. It's staged in a large, empty, big city diner that has an old-fashioned, faded elegance, the kind of place you might go to for dinner if you're all alone. Two men, each in their own worlds, pass the time with their newspapers as the shoppers on the street hurry past. This watercolor makes its point by depicting the character of the place and the people. This watercolor from 1928 has a very different purpose. This was his first trip to Europe when he was a young man on a painting fellowship. He was always intrigued by new places that gave him new situations to paint. Situations was his term for painting motifs or subjects. Here he lays out the scene, creates the rhythm, finds the colors, places the people, all in a very relaxed but analytical way. He's discovering his own sense of the character of this place. He's not reciting what he read in a travel book. This painting tells us what he learned during the morning he spent working on this watercolor. In 1934, just before they moved to Oregon for David's teaching position here, he and Ann went to New Mexico to be married. Here they are on their wedding day. My wife wants that dress. And her birthday is coming up, so I've got a job to do. This is the beginning of a new life for them, and there's a new landscape out there to discover. So when the ceremony was over, David got his paints out, or at least I hope he waited until the next day. And he made this simple searching painting as a way of discovering the surrounding countryside. It's laid out in his relaxed, analytical manner. It nicely captures the distinctive colors of New Mexico that were new to him. He was seeing with fresh eyes. And now a little later, also in 1934, he arrives in Eugene, where he was to teach and paint until he retired in the 1970s. And again, we see him learning the landscape by painting a simple scene. This looks like the outskirts of Eugene, the kind of place you'd hardly notice as you drive by. But he paints it with the eye of a newcomer and sees and captures the huge sky we have here and the colors on what was probably a winter day with a thin layer of clouds that the sun shines through. New landscapes gave McCosh new opportunities to find places to paint. The little industrial sites that he found all around Eugene, like this one, were wonderfully paintable. He said that Eugene was a hodgepodge of prim and proper urban and loose and easy country all mixed up together. Still is. A road heading out of town towards the Coast Range or the Coburg Hills. It's a threatening rain on this moody day in the late summer. This is one of the first large oil paintings McCosh made after he settled here. Oops, a little too fast. It's a summary of the character he found in that bend in the road. He sees deep, rich greens, dark rolling clouds up above, an undulating countryside, and a few perfectly placed stores at the bend. It's carefully observed and vibrantly painted. And then Vanita, muddy Vanita, 15 miles or so to the west of us, a sawmill that probably helped keep that town going in the 1930s. A stack of logs tumbling into the swooping, muddy road. This is a dramatic, eye-catching composition, much in the manner of the American scene painting of the day. It's also a very good characterization of the Willamette Valley in the fall. And that's the point of the paintings from this period. McCosh was hunting for situations that expressed the distinctive character of a place, and he used his skills as a painter to convert what he saw into a visually engaging depiction of that character. Of course, many other painters during this period were working that same vein. Marsden Hartley, for one, in this powerful depiction of a logging camp in the Maine woods. Edward Hopper, in this lonely and foreboding painting of a railroad yard in the bowels of a big eastern city. It's worth noting that McCosh's Vanita painting was exhibited alongside paintings by Hartley and Hopper in the American Pavilion at the New York 1939 World's Fair in New York. Big, powerful statements like Vanita are impressive and important accomplishments, but McCosh also had a more focused, analytical interest in painting that he found intellectually challenging and wanted to spend more time on. So in the 1940s, we see him adopting that second approach to painting as a way of learning how to see. He began to make paintings and drawings that focused on how he saw his subject. This was an idea that came from Paul Cézanne, who in many respects was a source of much 20th century modernist painting. McCosh said that when Cézanne began a drawing or a painting, he tried to answer the question, how do I know about this scene? Not what do I know about the scene. So McCosh began to pay more attention to how he actually observed his subject. What attracted his eye? How did he look around and through the scene? So he could make his drawing or painting show how he came to understand and appreciate his subject. This is the first of several pieces we'll look at from the late 30s and 40s and the 1940s that show him dealing with this concept. His favorite subject around Eugene in those days was the mill race. He loved all the rough and wild natural stuff, the bridges, the industrial buildings. Many people thought of the mill race as the slums of Eugene in those years, so no one had ever painted along the mill race before, and he loved that also. He thought it was the most interesting and paintable part of town. So this is a drawing of a scene along the mill race. He's made it simple by eliminating all the textures and colors and the details of the vegetation so he can focus on the structural components of the scene. We see the stream wandering off into the distance, the strong, irregular diagonals of the tree trunks, some standing straight, others collapsing gradually into the stream bed. This is the same scene, but he's moved two or three steps to the right. He's changed the angle of his view and is describing more of that landmass right here in the foreground. This new angle pushes the forms together and makes the composition more dynamic. He's also beginning to suggest colors with the black and gray tones he's added to the vegetation and the water. Same viewpoint, he's laying in color now. Not highly specific color, but it's very descriptive color. And if you look at the effect of the color in the landmass on the right, it causes you to slow down. Your eye stops there and moves more slowly before going on. The greens of the vegetation in the stream bed make the eye move more quickly off into the distance, just as his eye must have when he looked at and studied the scene. The black diagonals of the trees are real stopping points now for the eye. And here's a finished painting, not of the same site, but of the same mill race. And if you think about how your eye wanders around as you look at this scene, how it moves slowly and carefully in some areas, more rapidly in others, it's that way because that's the way he saw it as well, and he painted it to give that effect. It's a scene most people wouldn't look at twice, but he made it into a pretty engaging painting. McCosh moved back and forth during the late 1930s and the 1940s between more emotional characterizations we've seen and his closely observed analytical manner. The next two paintings illustrate the range that he had then. This is the old Western States power plant on the mill race. It's a fine, carefully made painting with masses of vegetation and colors that describe the fallen Eugene. It's laid out in his broad, relaxed, and analytical manner. Remember this willow here and this little stretch of the bridge down here. It's exactly the same spot. There's the bridge. He's standing a little farther back. There's the willow. But what a different painting. I think he had an extra cup of coffee this morning. I mean, this is highly energetic characterization. The forms are massed together more tightly, as you can see, and the colors are laid down flat and bright. They're not nuanced like they are in the other, in the last version we looked at. And that makes for an excitable composition. We'll look now at how he captured the character of the Fairmont neighborhood in Eugene in the 1940s, which is where he and Anne lived. And this is probably their backyard. And this is just a wonderfully informative painting. There's lots of information about this place here, and it's very vigorously painted or drawn. Here's a well laid out watercolor that states the open flowing quality of the neighborhood in those days, with the houses tucked into the landscape. It's probably their front yard there, and we're looking down the street. And a fine little painting of the neighborhood that does really what only a painting can do. It captures the muted glow of the sunset on that wall just perfectly. A photograph wouldn't do that justice, wouldn't do justice to the feeling of that sunset. These neighborhood scenes are so familiar to those of us who live here that we tend to take them for granted. They might seem more special if the architecture was less familiar, if these were farmhouses in Normandy, for example. But the reason they look so familiar is that he captured the character of this little neighborhood perfectly. And that's what we recognize. In spite of all this good work, by all accounts, McCosh was pretty discouraged at the end of the 1940s. He had a very heavy teaching load, and the challenges of his painting were simply wearing him down. In today's terminology, he was burned out. Anne told me that he worried his painting was getting stale. He needed a new direction, a new focus for his work. In 1947, he spent a semester visiting at Montana State University in Bozeman. As always, he was energized by that new landscape, which he lays out here in his relaxed but carefully observed manner. This is structurally very similar to the Fairmont neighborhood watercolor we just looked at. But what about this watercolor of a stream tumbling down a Montana mountainside? It's not just the energy that makes this painting engaging. He's showing us how he sees this situation he's painting. Notice how rapidly your eye moves around as the water flows closer to the bottom, and how the energy of the scene and its spatial complexity fills the entire page. It's just exactly as it filled his entire field of view as he stood in front of this scene. The work he did in Montana is an indication of things to come. This vibrant drawing of Horse Creek, which is a tributary of the Mackenzie where he and Anne had a cabin, is what his painting became in the 1950s and 60s, a few years after what we just looked at. It focuses on the physical characteristics of the landscape, like his earlier work. It also fills the scene with the page with the totality of the scene, the light, the shadows, the flow of the water, even the sounds. And the density and saturation of the ink marks define the space and even suggest the colors that this might be. So how did he get from the careful analysis of the Fairmont neighborhood to the vibrant energy of Horse Creek? Well, in 1949, David had his first sabbatical after 15 years of teaching, and it was just what he needed to break through his creative logjam. He and Anne spent their time in two places that were dramatically different from one another and dramatically different from Eugene. Mexico, but first here on Cohasset Beach in Washington, where his big breakthrough occurred. Cohasset Beach is a broad, sandy beach in Grace Harbor County, very much like the sandy beaches on the Long Beach Peninsula above Astoria, not particularly distinguished in terms of scenery, but Cohasset had an important connection to the art department at the U of O. The family of Lance Wood Hart, who taught painting at the U of O in the 1930s until his death in 1941, had a cabin on the beach that they made available to U of O faculty, so in the art department. So Anne and David spent about 3 months there in the fall and early winter of 1949. This striking piece by McCosh, which is in the permanent collection of the museum here, is from that time at Cohasset Beach. He's on the beach. He's looking down at a jumble of sticks, broken shells, rocks, seaweed that had been brought in by the tide. It looks like it's late in the day. And everything is painted roughly, just as he saw it. There's no effort to finally finish this work. He wanted it to be as direct and as immediate as his experience of the beach was. The Cohasset paintings, this is another one, are like prototypes of the work he would do over the next 20 years. Observational painting using techniques that match the primitive character of his subject, such as squeezing paint straight out of the tubes onto the surface and pushing it around with sticks he found on the beach. He's rethinking how he paints so he can more directly state how he sees his subject. These paintings are full of energy and potential. They're like the earliest paintings from the beginning of a new aesthetic movement, like the very first Cubist paintings or the very first abstract expressionist paintings. And that's what they were for McCosh. This was the beginning of his new aesthetic. So we'll look now at what he does with this manner of painting when he returns to Eugene in the 1950s and the 1960s. I'm going to start mixing in now a few photos that McCosh took of places or scenes to give us a different perspective on how he actually viewed his subjects, what his eye saw. He was a Sunday photographer, so he had the problems with exposures and the like that are common in the days before digital cameras. He didn't take many photos of potential painting subjects, so there aren't many of these out there. There are some in the archives, and I've sorted through them to find the ones that are most relevant, I think. He didn't actually make paintings or drawings from the photos, so we can't compare a photo to a painting to see what elements he included or what he altered. But they do give us an idea of what attracted his eye. One other thing about his photos that's important to note, everything in them is important. The shadows, the texture of the tree trunk, the way the branches extend from the tree, the character of the leaves, the colors of the background, the way the sky peeks through, it's all important. And he took this photo because everything in it interested him. So here's a drawing from 1953. That shows us how he sees a forest scene that includes a close-up view of a tree. This is probably the trunk right here. And there's another tree on the left-hand side. It's out in the sunshine because we can see the texture of the bark. Up in here, masses of leaves or needles, maybe ivy or other vegetation clustering around. Different spaces moving back, the darker areas are probably closer to the front of the painting or the drawing. This drawing tells us that he looked at this scene far more subjectively than any camera would. So here's another of his photos, a stand of trees in the woods with some complex vegetation in the foreground, probably some rhododendrons in bloom. And now a drawing that might involve a similar scene. Strong verticals representing trees. You can start to see the details on the trunk there. All of this, masses of vegetation, branches, vines. Perhaps these are rhododendron blossoms, these specks of white. McCosh referred to the drawings that we're looking at here as his night drawings because he made them at night in his studio without reference to a specific landscape situation. He was recalling the landscape situations he had observed so frequently over the years. And as he worked on these drawings, he was asking himself, how do I know these things? How do I see them? The drawings show us that his process of observation was at times very methodical and slow moving. At other times, his eye moved rapidly through the scene with great energy and excitement. Another of his photos, this is a tangle of blackberries. If this was in my black backyard, I'd be saying, I gotta clean this up this weekend. But he saw it differently. He saw it as a paintable subject. And for the next 15 years, he spent a lot of his time working on these tangles in complex spaces. So what do we have here? Notice the arching vines, a little bit of fence back here. The background we see, a bit of sky, and then many layers of vegetation. Can't see real deeply into it, but you have a feeling for how complex that space is if you start to carefully look at it. So how could this be a subject for a painting? We have to remember that what McCosh was after at this point is that he wanted to paint how he saw his subject, not what he saw. So again, this isn't a painting of the tangle in the photo, but you get the general idea. These linear elements could be vines. This could be leaves. Some are in the shade. Some are in the sun. This vertical element could be a tree or some vegetation that stands straight up. This could be part of a fence back here. You know, it's important to note that I'm describing the connections that can be made between the marks in this drawing and physical objects as a way to explain his new way of seeing. It's really not necessary to do that, to try to figure out what every mark represents in order to appreciate this work. Once you understand his general purpose, you know enough to get a lot out of this just by looking carefully and becoming engaged in these complex spaces. Here's a more generalized view of a tangle of vegetation. Very fast, rapidly moving lines that probably represent something like the vines in those blackberry bushes. Two tree trunks on the right, one on the left. Various masses indicating vegetation, and these empty spaces. They could be large masses of vegetation he didn't block in, or we could be looking back to the space behind with these. So we'll move now into the 1950s, 1958 to be exact, and we're going to be with McCosh in Vence, France. He's on his second sabbatical now. And we'll look through some of the work from that trip to see how this concept of painting as a way of learning to see was applied to his discovery of this very new landscape for him. We'll start with a couple of drawings he made as he's getting a feel for the place. This spacious drawing invites us to just walk up this wonderful path with the swaying trees, the trees swaying in the breeze on either side, up to this very interesting village up at the top. He's done a fine job of inviting us to explore this place. Now we're up on top of the hill, and we're standing in front of a fine old villa with a ancient olive tree staggering up into the sky. The natural is contrasted with the man-made. The railing here relates nicely to the curvature of the branches. This is a really very visual, quick sketch, and it's worth noting all the stuff he left out of it. There's a whole ton of detail here he could have focused on. The surface of this, of this building, more character or more detail in the tree trunk, but he left it out so he could focus instead on the fundamentals that attracted his eye, and the result was a drawing of real clarity. So now we're on top of the hill, looking at the buildings in the middle of the village that we saw from the distance, and what a difference these colors make. We see it's a cloudy day. The leaves on the olive trees are a dark blue-green in that light, and the clouds are purple-violet with some green mixed in. The varied colors on the ground suggest that it's probably been raining there. This might be puddles or some mud remnants. The air feels wet and humid. We're not far from the Mediterranean in Vence. The heavy paint he used creates that wet, humid feeling. Imagine if instead of looking at this watercolor, you were looking at a photograph of this scene. It would give us a lot more specific detail, but not nearly as much information as this watercolor gives us about the day and the feeling of the place. So we've moved up close to an olive tree now, and we see him using patches of color to indicate shade, moss, sunlight maybe peeking through on the tree trunks. We look through the shadow of the tree towards the building, its whitewashed walls and roof sort of dimly glowing, or kind of glowing in that dim light right now. Again, this drawing creates an experience of the place that goes beyond simply describing the appearance of the place. Now we're in the brilliant sunlight of the south of France. The colors are dazzling in their bright intensity. The shadows on the tree trunks, I have a purple tint to them as they run up the tree. The leaves become green in the bright light. The rich stucco walls and roofs are red and orange. They just bask in the sunlight. This is a vibrant painting full of life. Sometimes we think of McCosh as a quiet, personal, contemplative painter, kind of reflective of the cloudy environment of the Pacific Northwest. But he was very capable of lively, brilliantly colored work like this, which we see more and more frequently in the 1950s and 60s. The clouds have moved in, and now we're looking at a grove of olive trees heavily laden with leaves, with the light filtering down around and through them. You can see the buildings in the back. This is a very perceptive painting. It's based, as always, on observation, but it embraces the whole experience of this place. I've mentioned Cézanne and how important his thinking was to McCosh about painting from observation. Cézanne's late oil paintings from the 1880s on are different from McCosh's late work from the 1950s and beyond. Cézanne focuses more on the structural integrity created through minutely graduated color modulations in his late oil paintings. But his late watercolors, such as Forest Path, this one, show us the common ground that he and McCosh shared. They were both interested in presenting the totality of the visual experience of their subject. Both were methodical, careful observers, and each was a master of his very individual approach to color. This is a different scene than the McCosh watercolors we've just been looking at, but Cézanne treats the effect of light in a similar manner as he filters it through the canopy of the trees to create the spaces and the overall environment of that path. One last look at a McCosh olive tree. The leaves are down now, so we see the meticulous structure of the tree. McCosh is so involved in understanding and observing this tree. Imagine the amount of time it took to work this drawing out, that the drawing embodies the rhythms and the movement of the tree's growth. He wasn't striving for photographic realism. If he attempted to capture every bump and tittle in those branches and twigs, this drawing would probably be stiff and lifeless. Instead, it's loose and free, which makes this tree alive and thriving. McCosh admired the remarkable intensity and focus of Vincent van Gogh's observation and the extraordinary engagement we see in his great drawings. I say in one of the essays in the book that Van Gogh became so deeply engrossed in this drawing that it's like he actually became a part of this garden. He felt its rhythms and its varied textures as he drew, which explains why this work is so memorable for us. We're back in Oregon now, in our own backyard. Kind of a big change. The forests around the Mackenzie River and Horse Creek in the 1960s and early 70s, tangle of blackberry vines and all other variations, lots of strong vertical elements here in the different planes as we move towards the back, which creates many interesting spaces in and through the tangles. And here's a night drawing that suggests a way of looking at the tangle comparable to the one in the photo. Notice how he's using short strokes or lines to indicate vines or branches and to move the eye through this. The varying degrees of density of ink suggest vegetation at varying depths. The white areas bend and twist the space. They could be openings in the vegetation that reach back into the space, or large masses like a tree trunk or branch that the vegetation entwines. Remember the comment a few slides back about exploring the spaces in the drawings. This is just the sort of evocative piece that invites that kind of viewing. Tree trunks, vines, masses of vegetation moving through layers of space, and colors, which make the different passages of the drawing move at different speeds. The work from this period is some of the most innovative and original painting to have come from the Pacific Northwest. This is a spot along the Mackenzie River. The stream runs over and around the boulders. Mottled sunlight and shade, moss and lush vegetation on the rock wall from the alongside the far bank. And here's a painting of a dimly lit stream. We see the dark blue-green colors of the water reflecting up into the air, with spots of sunlight floating along the far edge. Notice how the rocks, the water, the vegetation are all defined loosely by lines, but the colors are not restricted to those objects. They inhabit them, but they also float freely and color the air, just as Cézanne indicated in the forest path watercolor we saw. Here's another stream running through the woods, this time in the sunshine with the colors of the rocks, the water, and the vegetation just dancing in the air. And one final photo. This is a really classic woodland scene with all the verticals, the diagonals, the flowers in the foreground, the various vegetations, the spaces, the sun or the sky in the background. He's actually getting the hang of photography now. And here's a more literal description of a similar scene by McCosh. And it includes this nice little path back into the deeper reaches of the forest that's just inviting to walk through. And here's an especially vivid and elegant painting that shows how interrelated and engaging his forest imagery has become. Oops, go back here a little bit and look at this one just a little bit more. Big tree trunk, probably another tree in here. Vegetation moving about, maybe some sunlight, perhaps some flowers, spots of green. Just a wonderfully engaging piece that you can spend a long time looking at. The late work we've been looking at reaches that third level of painting as seeing. This is more than a record of his discovery of the character of the scene or a demonstration of how he observed landscape situations. He's exploring the potential of painting and drawing to create meaning, as poetry and music does. Not through a literal description of the world, but through the creation of a work of art that states the essence of an experience in a form we can all share. Is that essence the complexity of these tangled webs and their deep and involved spaces? Perhaps, but the late works also show us there's a pattern, a complexity, a structure that brings order and life to the complexity we see. These works are the experiences of an individual who discovered that through painting, something that goes beyond what he was able to observe. McCosh is not often thought of as a spiritual painter, whose work reflects or participates in ideas that transcend painting itself. But this late work in particular has a spiritual dimension that results from his discovery of order, structure, and simplicity in complex and chaotic environments. Thank you all very much for your kind attention. That's David probably on his front porch in about 1960. Are there any questions anyone has or any comments you'd like to make? Be happy to take them. Yes, John.
Yes, you mentioned his radical
cohesive. Yeah.
And you mentioned Mexico, but I don't think you said anything about San Miguel's Allende.
Yeah.
Also spent some time.
He sure did, yeah. He loves San Miguel de Ante. And John knows quite a bit about that place. That's the subject of another lecture, but he did some wonderful, wonderful work there. Tremendous character in Mexico that he captured, and wonderful colors, very special colors. He loved it. Yes? Yes?
Were your three categories of his painting derived primarily from what he wrote and the conversations that they were in, or were they derived primarily from inferences based on examining his painting?
From both, really. He did write a lot about character. He wrote a lot about Cézanne and that method of painting, how you see, not what you see. Excuse me, I'll get back here again. He did write a lot about discovering character. And he wrote a lot about painting how you see, not what you see. He didn't say much about essence. That's my own belief based on working with this for a long period of time and trying to explain it and understand it. What makes it so special? If all it was kind of a document or a record, it wouldn't have nearly the impact that some of this work does. And the only way to explain it is he is actually explaining complexity in a very important way by showing us patterns that allow us to grasp it and deal with it. It's a great question, thank you. Any others? Yes?
Was he more attracted to a purely natural scene, because he does both natural scenes, or to a social and urban?
Well, you know, it's very interesting. When he was in Chicago, you would have thought that his career would have been social urban scenes, because that's what he was painting, because that's what he was in at that time. When he moved out here to Oregon, everything shifted. The landscape became his primary focus. He still did portraits, particularly in the late 30s and the 40s. He did still life paintings, which are really wonderful, but his real forte was the landscape, what we've been focusing on. Yes? Those might be the tangles that we're talking about, those very late night drawings. I think they are.
Yeah.
And one way of understanding them is to try to relate them to these very complex vegetation things that we see when, you know, weeds and everything grows freely. And I think that's why I showed the photos, because that seems to be what maybe got him going in that direction. I agree with you. I really agree with you. I mean, those last four drawings that I showed, the little groups of weeds gradually getting simpler and simpler. When I look at those, I think of a Bach partita. You know, just the beauty of something like that. That's what those drawings give to me. I think they're very emotional. They really are. Yeah. Yes? Mm-hmm. They do. They hold several. I've never seen them on display there, but they do have some from his student days primarily. Yeah. We'd like to place something of his later work there one day. Mm-hmm. Yes?
The last slide you showed reminded me immediately of the work there.
It does, yes, doesn't it? Yeah.
And I wondered if he had, with his depiction of nature,
yeah.
I wondered if he had some type of spirituality. I wondered about his spirituality with respect with nature.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. I was thinking about who can you compare to McCosh in his late work? Who are the people out there who would, and you know, there aren't that many, but if you think about the Pacific Northwest, Graves was reaching for some of that same essence, particularly in his earlier work, which is very primal and basic. When he's, one of the things I think that Graves did a little differently than McCosh is Graves tended to want to inhabit his subjects and take on their persona. And you sometimes have the impression that a lot of his paintings of birds and flowers are really a form of self-portrait almost. He's becoming that subject. I don't think McCosh got engaged in quite that way. I think what he tapped into, though, was the energy of what he was observing. And it's the same thing we see in Van Gogh. That's what makes those works so incredibly powerful. He looked so deeply that he became a part of that thing and felt its energy and was able to put that on the page or on the canvas. Yes?
In that same vein, there was some painting that you showed of the beach.
Yes.
And I thought I saw birds in that painting.
Saw birds?
I thought I saw people.
Could be.
We were talking about the
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, there could be. It wouldn't be. Sometimes, you know, the more you look at his paintings, the more you see. It's really true. I mean, I've got paintings that I've lived with of his for years, and I still see new things in them. It's really quite remarkable that way. But that's very possible. It wouldn't be surprising at all. One of the things he loved about Cohasset and what made it such a big deal is it's a tidal beach. So every day it changed. Every day things would be swept in and they would be in these natural masses on the beach. Nobody arranged them. You know, nobody tried to make them pretty. It was just as basic and as fundamental as you could possibly be. And when he decided he was going to paint that, that's what changed everything for him, because then he realized his painting technique needed to reflect that scene. Any others? Well, thank you all very much. Really appreciate you being here. Thank you.